Hello everyone, I'm Sandro Esteves, and I'm very happy to be participating and co-chairing the virtual world conference on luteinized hormone in ART, the second edition, that will span from September to December 2020. This year, the conference is completely different. Obviously, we will love to meet you in person, but due to the constraints posed by the COVID-19 around the globe, we decided to go ahead with the conference and have a very exciting program with reach of, let's say, a new experience that you'll be able to have using the website that was created by Medea Medical Education Academy. So we will have video talks like the one that I will deliver today, but we will have much more, like meet the expert sessions. We will have chat room for interaction. We will have a call for abstracts, and we'll select the best ones for awarding and presentation and much more. Today, I will talk about the role of LH in male infertility, which is an important thing for clinicians working with male patients in clinical practice. During this talk, I will first of all explain the role of LH in spermatogenesis. Then I will move to a more clinical scenarios in which I will discuss with you the male infertility scenarios that you might consider giving LH activity to improve the success rates of your male patients undergoing ART. And then I will share with you how we do in clinical practice the way I practice in my center, Andro Ferg, in Campinas, Brazil. So the first thing that we need to go back a little bit is related to the physiology. As you know well, spermatogenesis is regulated primarily by FSH and LH-driven testosterone. So the Sertoli cell is like the male counterpart of the granulosa cells. This is the place where spermatogenesis takes place. So in this illustration, you see the pituitary, you see the gonadotropins, and then LH, as you can see, acts on the Leydig cells. Leydig cells to make testosterone. Testosterone then go through the bloodstream and then enter the Sertoli cells. The Sertoli cells, as you can see in green, is the place where spermatogenesis takes place. So everything we do for our male infertility patients in terms of medication or any intervention to improve spermatogenesis, it's important to understand that spermatogenesis will take in humans about 74 days. So we need to wait that period of time to fully appreciate the intervention that we are giving to our patients. Concerning LH, the main action of LH relates, as I said before, to binding to the receptor at the Leydig cell and then generating, promoting testosterone production. So testosterone then goes to the bloodstream and then will enter the Sertoli cells. So the main function of LH is actually stimulate testosterone production at the Leydig cells. But LH also control its own receptors. So the expression of the receptors, the membrane receptors at the Leydig cells is regulated by LH. And also LH has an important role in the differentiation of Leydig cells. Besides, there are some growth factors produced by the Leydig cells that are regulated through LH activity. For instance, spermatogonia proliferation is an important aspect that is regulated by LH. So it is really important molecule for spermatogenesis. Testosterone, which is the main, let's say, hormone produced by the Leydig cells, will act at the Sertoli cells by binding the androgen receptor. Unlike the FSH and LH receptors, which are membrane receptors. The androgen receptors is intracellular receptor. So this is very important that the testosterone enters the Sertoli cells, bind to the androgen receptor to promote, support spermatogenesis, and also secrete testosterone-dependent products that will support the full differentiation of the germ cells. But the most important thing that we need to know about testosterone is that its primary function in spermatogenesis is at the later stages, is post-meiotic progression of round spermatids to mature sperm. So the end stage, spermiogenesis, is highly dependent on intratesticular testosterone. Intratesticular testosterone is about 100 times higher. So the amount of testosterone that we have in the testicles, which is called intratesticular testosterone, is 100 times higher than what we measure in the blood. And this testosterone, as I said before, is LH-driven. So this is important because intratesticular testosterone is needed for the transition from type A to type B spermatogonia. It is important for the upregulation of the androgen receptor, so it can improve the Sertoli cell function. But as I said before, the primary action is at the end part of spermatogenesis, which is called spermiogenesis, is from the progression of round spermatid to mature sperm. We should not forget the action of FSH, which is extremely important because FSH will act with LH to kind of support the spermatogenesis process. So the FSH will provide this structural and metabolic support for spermatogenesis. And where is the FSH receptor? The FSH receptor is located at the Sertoli cells. So FSH will regulate the Sertoli cell number, which is important to fully support spermatogenesis. However, FSH is not mandatory for the completion of spermatogenesis. But if we have deficient FSH, the sperm quantity will be markedly reduced. So again, a combination of both molecules is key. And the best way to understand the individual roles of these molecules is by looking at animal models, knockout mice. For instance, when we go for the knockout mice in which either the LH receptor is missing or the gonadotropin itself, I mean, LH molecule is defective, or the androgen receptor is defective, the endpoint will be maturation arrest. So as I said before, the last part of spermatogenesis, spermiogenesis, will not occur. And then we have maturation arrest. By contrast, if we have a problem with FSH receptor or FSH itself as a gonadotropin, these knockout mice, they lack the action of FSH. And then the final result will be reduced testicular volume and decreased spermatogenesis, but spermatogenesis will not be fully disrupted. So again, highlighting the differential effects of LH and FSH on spermatogenesis. So the key points of this first part of my talk is that spermatogenesis is regulated primarily by FSH and LH-driven testosterone. The main function of LH is to stimulate intratesticular testosterone production by the Leydig cells. Intratesticular testosterone primary function will relate to maturation, the last stages of spermatogenesis, from round spermatid to mature sperm, which is called spermiogenesis. And FSH is also important with the primary function to increase sperm quantity, working together with intratesticular testosterone, helping cell proliferation, sperm quantity. Now I want to move to my second point. in this part, I will talk about male infertility scenarios in which we can apply the knowledge that I explained to you before to benefit our patients. In fact, gonadotropin therapy has been a part of the medical treatment in male infertility for many, many years. And here, I want to share with you some data related to the action of the molecules, both HCG and LH, on testosterone production. Well, for many years, we have been using HCG instead of LH to stimulate testosterone production. And we know why. It's because the molecules share similar characteristics and they bind to the same receptor. So it means that HCG has been used as LH activity, promoting LH activity, because HCG is available for many years. And urologists, reproductive urologists and andrologists have been using, exploring HCG in male infertility. So when we give HCG to a patient, here you see in the open squares, 5,000 international units of urinary HCG, and then in the solid squares, you see recombinant HCG, 250 micrograms, which is about 6,500 international units. So the administration of HCG promotes testosterone increase. So you see that it lasts up to 5 days, but you see a continuous increase in testosterone production with the administration of one single injection of HCG. Another important thing to look at this graph over the right side is that it's dose dependent. So the higher the HCG dose that you give, the higher the testosterone production. And also by giving HCG, you increase the production of estradiol, which sometimes is not very good because estradiol, as you know, when it's high, could inhibit the pituitary. And in some cases in male infertility, we will need to add aromatase inhibitors to control for these high estradiol levels. But the key point here is that when you give HCG one shot, you get increase in testosterone production that will last about 5 to 7 days. The second part that I want to share with you is that the administration of recombinant LH can have similar effects. Here in the solid squares, you see that after single injection of recombinant LH, 150 international units, there is a marked increase in serum LH levels that will last for about 2 hours. So it's different than HCG because HCG is longer. The action of recombinant LH is shorter. You see that the action will last about 2 hours. There is no marked increase in estradiol levels, which is good. There is an increase in testosterone after one injection of 150 units recombinant LH. 4 hours later, we get significantly higher testosterone production. And like HCG, there's a dose-dependent increase in testosterone production according to the amount of LH you give to your patients. So both HCG and LH go into the same receptor and promote testosterone production. So the Leydig cell function will be kind of stimulated with the injection of either recombinant LH or HCG. However, as you can see in this graph, and here in the X axis, you see the testosterone production, the testosterone with administration of recombinant HCG. And on the Y, you see the testosterone increase according to recombinant LH. So you see that the line is shifted to the right, means that HCG is more potent to promote testosterone production compared to LH. So you can see here easily that I give that amount, I will have more testosterone by HCG compared to LH. And this is easily explained by the half-life of this molecule in the circulation and also in the target organ. So these are important physiological considerations for you to consider, because when you go for the clinical male infertility scenarios, the main goal is actually to restore or optimize Sertoli cell function. So one example is the patient with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. In these patients, they have LH deficient production or action. The second scenario that we can consider promoting LH activity is actually patients with intrinsic spermatogenesis impairment. For instance, non-obstructive azoospermic patients. So let's start with the hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, which is not common in the clinical practice, but we see these patients. We may have patients with congenital hypo-hypo, acquired hypo-hypo, for instance, some pituitary surgery, tumors, use of testosterone replacement therapy for long periods of time. We can have idiopathic hypo-hypo. In these patients, the main issue is that LH and FSH levels are very low, and these patients have azoospermia, absence of spur in the ejaculate. Why? Because there's lack of adequate testicular stimulation by the pituitary gonadotropins. So the treatment that has been used for many, many years is actually to replace what is missing. And we usually replace by giving HCG. So if the patient is post-pubertal, I mean, the hypo-hypo is kind of, the onset is adult, in that case scenario, we can start with HCG alone and then add FSH if needed. However, if it's prepubertal hypo-hypo, we need to give both HCG and FSH. We need to stimulate both target organs at the same time. Usually we give HCG 1,000 to 5,000 international units twice a week. And then we add FSH, could be recombinant FSH, urinary FSH, 75 to 225 international units, 2 to 3 times a week. The duration is usually long, 3 to 18 months. And we need to follow up with the blood tests for the hormones, the physical examination, the ultrasound, and the semen analysis. But this therapy is quite effective. So this is a study we did some time ago. This is adult onset hypo-hypo in which we give HCG. In this study, we gave HCG just once a week for at least 12 weeks, adding FSH as needed. And what we found was a significant increase in total testosterone levels with treatment, increase in the testicular volume, and also completely shift from azoospermia to normal sperm production in most men. So when we go for the summary evidence concerning LH-based gonadotropin therapy in hypo-hypo males, the treatment can restore spermatogenesis in up to 90% of patients. However, there's variation in the degree of spermatogenesis restoration. Some patients achieve normal semen analysis and others will need assisted reproductive technology. But the reported pregnancy rates are up to 65% using, as I said, natural pregnancy or assisted conception. The sperm count is usually higher when we combine HCG with FSH versus HCG alone, but we still need randomized controlled trials comparing different drugs and regimens. The treatment is long and might be expensive. The follow-up is mandatory with the hormone testing and semen analysis. And if the patient starts to produce sperm, I usually offer sperm banking. And if after 6 or longer months of treatment and I don't see sperm in the ejaculate, I discuss with my patient sperm retrieval. That could be done to kind of find sperm in the testes and then freeze for future use with assisted reproduction technology. So this is the clinical scenario for hypo-hypo, but unfortunately, this is not common in clinical practice. This is the scenario that we have in our center at Androfer. Hypo-hypo corresponds to only 3% of the azoospermic patients we see. In most cases, our azoospermic patients are non-obstructive azoospermia due to intrinsic testicular failure. This is much more common. And we can have congenital cases like Y chromosome microdeletions, Klinefelter syndrome, retortidism. We can have acquired cases like mumps orchitis, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and also idiopathic cases. In these cases, unlike hypo-hypo, azoospermia is due to lack of sperm production due to intrinsic testicular deficiency in patients with non-obstructive azoospermia due to spermatogenic failure. We usually have high FSH levels. LH levels could be high or in the upper limits. And it's very common in at least 50% of these patients that we have low testosterone production. So in patients with non-obstructive azoospermia, because the sperm retrieval success rates are suboptimal, only 30 to 50% of these men will succeed in having sperm retrieved by any of the procedure that you may like to use. In our center, we prefer the microdissection testicular sperm extraction that has been shown to provide the best results in terms of sperm retrieval in patients with non-obstructive azoospermia. But even using the best approach, the success rate is not more than 50%. So gonadotropin therapy has been explored to optimize or induce spermatogenesis and increase sperm retrieval rates, eventually have some sperm in the ejaculate of men with non-obstructive azoospermia. Several authors have done that, including us, exploring the possibility of what I explained to you before, stimulating Sertoli cell function by boosting testosterone production. And this is the main issue when we discuss possibility of providing treatment for male infertility patients with non-obstructive azoospermia. We would like to increase intratesticular testosterone production because men with non-obstructive azoospermia, as I told you before, they have small testicles in general and low testosterone production. Why? Because the number of cells, Sertoli cells, are not high. The number of Leydig cells are also decreased. So if we are able to increase intratesticular testosterone production, we might be able to stimulate the later stages of spermatogenesis. So if there is island of sperm production available in that particular testis, we might be able to actually work and improve. And this is what we see when we give HCG. We increase remarkably the intratesticular testosterone production. The other important thing that happens when we give HCG is that we reset FSH, because by giving HCG and increasing testosterone production, there will be inhibition in the pituitary and FSH levels, which are usually high, will go down to normal levels. And this is important because then the receptors that were downregulated will start to pop up again, and then we could actually promote a better environment for the Sertoli cells to support the spermatogenesis. And this is interesting because the studies have shown that we can also increase spermatogonia DNA synthesis after HCG plus FSH therapy in men with non-obstructive azoospermia. So this is the main issue that have been explored in men with non-obstructive azoospermia. The gonadotropin therapy may optimize or induce spermatogenesis and increase sperm retrieval success rates. The treatment that has been explored is by using HCG alone or the combination HCG plus FSH. Usually, HCG is given twice a week, and recombinant urinary FSH is given 2 or 3 times a week. Again, the duration is, like I said before, for hypo-hypo patients from 2 to 18 months, and we need to do the follow-up with the hormone levels, the physical examination, ultrasound, and the semen analysis. Here, I would like to share some of the studies that have been done using this approach. For instance, in patients with Klinefelter syndrome, and non-obstructive azoospermia, we see that after boosting intratesticular testosterone production using HCG, we may increase the sperm retrieval rate. This is a study of about 70 patients who have been treated by medication to improve intratesticular testosterone production. And in patients who actually had a positive response, meaning increasing in total testosterone measured in the periphery, peripheric blood, the positive response in that study was considered when there was more than 100 nanograms per deciliter increase in testosterone from baselines, the sperm retrieval success was 72% in that patient population compared with 55% in patients without response. This is another study looking at the overall population of non-obstructive azoospermic patients. And again, they have used HCG primarily combined or not with HMG to promote, to improve spermatogenesis in men with non-obstructive azoospermia. The author's target testosterone level was 600 to 800 nanograms per deciliter in the periphery. So they titrated the dose to achieve those levels. And then they have observed that sperm retrieval by microtizzy, which, as I said before, this is the best approach to retrieve sperm in men with non-obstructive azoospermia, was significantly higher in treated patients compared to controls. And interestingly, in this study, 11% of treated men had sperm in the ejaculates and not for ICSI, meaning that they don't need actually to go for sperm retrieval. So this is interesting approach for this sort of patients. This is another study in which the authors look at the most difficult scenario, I mean, non-obstructive azoospermic patients with failed microtizzy. So they gave these patients HCG twice a week, 5,000 international units for 3 to 5 months. And then they add FSH, 150 international units twice a week. When the FSH levels goes down very much, let's say less than 3 milli international units per liter, in some cases the FSH levels are high at the beginning of treatment, but goes down, we need to give FSH. So they showed that after treatment, 21.4% of this patient population who had negative microtizzy before without treatment, the authors were able actually to find the sperm in the testes for performing ICSI. So it was fantastic achievement in these patients who might be considered completely sterile. We have also explored this approach, and I published in Asian Journal of Andrology the algorithm that we use in our center that starts with HCG twice a week. We adjust the HCG dose to achieve testosterone levels, I mean total testosterone levels between 500 and 800 nanograms per deciliter, which is similar to 17 to 28 nanomoles per liter. So I add recombinant FSH 2 or 3 times a week. When the FSH levels drop to about 1.5 or below, I may add aromatase inhibitor if the testosterone to estradiol ratio is below 10. I mean, when there is excessive estradiol levels, so aromatase activity is excessive, we may find need to add aromatase inhibitors. So you need to play with the gonadotropin therapy, adjust your medication accordingly. The treatment duration should be from 3 to 18 months, but usually I like to give at least 6 months treatment before going for sperm retrieval. And I do the follow-up with the blood testing monthly and the semen analysis also, because we may find some patients with few sperm in the ejaculate that we can actually freeze and use for ICSI. And this is an example of a case report we treated recently, a patient with non-obstructive azoospermia due to cryptorchidism. This patient, we started treatment using the protocol that I just explained to you. So we started with HCG. We titrated the dose to kind of be in the right, let's say, range for the total testosterone level, so adjusting the dose. So when FSH levels drop significantly, we start giving recombinant FSH to kind of keep in the normal levels. So as you can see, the treatment was kind of monitored closely. And then when we achieved nice, let's say, hormonal profile, we started to see a few sperm in the ejaculate. This patient was non-obstructive azoospermia before. We started freezing sperm with conventional methods, which was not so successful in this case. We shifted the method for sperm vitrification, and then we were able to achieve a live birth by ICSI using frozen thaw ejaculated sperm that were vitrified. And we were able to achieve a full-term live birth of a healthy child, of a patient who was previously non-obstructive azoospermia, so using gonadotropin therapy. I would like to summarize the evidence regarding LH-based gonadotropin therapy for men with non-obstructive azoospermia due to spermatogenic failure. So the evidence we have are overwhelmingly based on observational trials and case series, which suggests gonadotropin therapy might increase sperm retrieval success or allow, in some case, presence of sperm in the ejaculate. The best candidates include the hypogonadal men. Who are those? These are men with total testosterone levels below 300 nanograms per deciliter, Klinefelter syndrome patients, and men with histopathology showing maturation arrest, in particular, late-stage maturation arrest or hypospermatogenesis. The treatment, likewise, I said for hypogonadotropic hypogonadism patients, treatment is long, might be expensive, and we need to follow up this patient with hormone testing and semen analysis. In our center, we offer sperm banking when we start seeing some sperm in the ejaculate. And if we don't see sperm in the ejaculate, which is what the usual scenario, we go for sperm retrieval using microdissection testicular sperm extraction. So the last part of my talk, I would just want to dedicate a few minutes to summarize what we do at Androford in terms of the clinical management of patients with the possibility to apply gonadotropin therapy. We created what we called ITESGO. ITESGO is an acronym for individualized testicular gonadotropin therapy. So how we do ITESGO at Androford? Well, if the patient has hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, and then we need to see if it's congenital or adult onset hypo-hypo. In the congenital case, we give HCG plus recombinant FSH from the start. If the patient is adult onset hypo-hypo, we start with HCG for the first 3 months, and then we add recombinant FSH as needed for another 3 to 12 months with the goal of having sperm in the ejaculate, because these patients might be able to achieve natural pregnancy or if the sperm quantity is not enough for natural pregnancy, we may explore intrauterine insemination or assisted reproductive technology, IVF ICSI. We follow these patients monthly with the hormone levels, the physical examination, and the semen analysis. The first semen analysis actually is carried out after 3 month treatment. Now, how we do I test for non-obstructive azoospermia? Here we have two different scenarios. One scenario is the patient with hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. I mean, the testicular size is reduced, FSH levels are high, and the testosterone levels are either low or borderline. This is like this category of patients. In this case, we give HCG, most often recombinant HCG, alone for the first 3 months. And then we add recombinant FSH twice or three times a week when the FSH levels goes below 1.5 international units per liter. So usually the FSH levels are high at the beginning, but when we start giving HCG, as I said before, there's a inhibition in the pituitary and the FSH levels goes down. And you might need to add FSH for these patients. And we keep giving and monitoring the patient over the course of treatment. The other scenario that we have in terms of non-obstructive azoospermia and intrinsic testicular failure is the condition in which we have maturation arrest. I mean, this spermatogenesis is fully arrested at certain stage. It could be spermatogonia or spermatocytes or even spermatid. In this patient, the testicular size is normal and FSH levels are normal as well. Testosterone levels usually normal. So in this patient population, we need to start low dose HCG. And then we also give in combination FSH. So it's important that we monitor very closely these patients with a low dose HCG to avoid exceeding the ceiling, because if you promote too much testosterone production, you can shut down the pituitary and then you create a situation that is iatrogenic. So this is what happens when urologists and other doctors prescribe testosterone, exogenous testosterone to patients with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism or non-obstructive azoospermia. This is completely wrong because you create supraphysiological levels of testosterone, there you shut down the pituitary, intratesticular testosterone production will not occur because you don't have stimulation from LH to the Leydig cells. So you make the situation very bad for the patient. So never prescribe exogenous testosterone. We need to explore gonadotropin therapy, yes, using the rationale that I explained to you during this talk. So in this case, we follow the patients with the hormonal levels, the physical examination, the semen analysis, and the goals are to kind of increase the testosterone levels that we measure in the blood because you reflect the intratesticular testosterone. The goal is to have between 500 to 800 nanograms per deciliter testosterone. In some cases, it's not possible to achieve that goal, but we try to go as much as possible closer to that, to those levels. And we are aiming to increase the sperm retrieval success by sperm retrieval method you use. I use microtizzy, or eventually have sperm in the ejaculate. So the take home messages of my talks, first of all, spermatogenesis in terms of the pathophysiology, we can say for sure that spermatogenesis is regulated primarily by FSH and LH-driven testosterone. So the LH main function is to stimulate intratesticular testosterone production by the Leydig cells. And intratesticular testosterone is extremely important for sperm maturation, the later stages of spermatogenesis. And also intratesticular testosterone will act in synergy with FSH for cell proliferation. FSH is very important for sperm quantity. So they work together. So in terms of the clinical scenarios that we explored, LH-based gonadotropin therapy can be used, explored as medical treatment in male infertility in two particular male infertility scenarios. One scenario is patients with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism that we will provide HCG therapy combined with FSH to restore spermatogenesis. And also for men with non-obstructive azoospermia due to intrinsic testicular failure, we may explore the use of HCG combined with FSH, alone or combined with FSH, to increase the Sertoli cell function, increase intratesticular testosterone production, reset FSH levels, and then increase sperm retrieval success rates, eventually allowing these patients to have some sperm in the ejaculate, or, I mean, having any sperm from the testicle or from the ejaculate for intracytoplasmic sperm injection, allowing these patients to have biological parenthood. But despite of all these things, we still need high quality studies because the existing evidence is overwhelmingly dependent on case series and retrospective cohort studies. We need to evaluate the optimal regimen, the duration, and in prospective studies, explore and provide more robust evidence of the clinical utility of gonadotropin therapy, specifically in men with non-obstructive azoospermia. Thank you very much for your attention.